Okay, we are live. So welcome back for session 19, our last session. It's kind of sad. In CEE 120C, 220C. Today we're going to talk about just really some tips about how to approach kind of changing these parametric hours based on some questions that have come up in office hours and trying to help people look at their specific problems. I've seen some really cool building forms. People have done a really good job of kind of creating some flexible forms. So what we're going to do is spend some time kind of thinking about how to use some of the evaluation nodes and things to help you once you just sort of varied your forms and you're trying to like analyze it. So we'll give you some tips up front about how to approach it. But then the latter part of the process, I really like to just go ahead and look at people's building forms and sort of see what sort of data you're coming up with so far and like sort of see what kind of problems people are having, see if we can answer some questions. In particular, you know, we're going to look at two things that are some of the come up problems or challenges for people early on as they're going. One is the whole notion of if you are creating a tower and it has somehow tapered surfaces or irregular surfaces to it, the panelization scheme that we typically use often doesn't work. It sort of gives you lots of extras. So we're going to take a look at an example of how you can address that, kind of a custom node that does some panelization using a special method. We'll also look at the energy analysis node, and that the energy analysis node does a pretty good job of what it's supposed to do, but it's often slow about what it's doing. So as you're executing your Dynamo scripts, you may be getting nulls because you're basically racing ahead and getting answers before the analysis is actually complete. And sort of an easy way to break that node into two different segments to go through and allow you to run the analysis and go back and get the results later. You don't have to be waiting on the results. And that's okay for what we're doing, because if we're just really trying to collect a lot of EUI data or energy data out of the analysis, we can do it after we've varied a whole bunch of different forms, give the analysis tool a chance to run in the background. So if you can, let's go ahead and if you can, just open up the session 19 Dynamo examples. We'll start there. And we'll address just sort of the issue of how we can go through and like handle towers that are a little bit odd. Irregular, I should say. See, I can switch around here a little bit. I closed it. Let me go back. A little opening up here. I'll go out to spring 16, 19. We're going to go to example 19.1, panelizing irregular surfaces. If you can, get that panelizing irregular surfaces.rvt file. Came up as we were working together with some students about how to panelize a surface like this, about how to handle, it's really surfaces that have a taper to it. So for example, the surface that you're seeing panelized towards the front right now, it's not a regular rectangular surface. It actually has sort of a funny shape to it. You know what's going on. And a lot of the towers that we're working on, because we're twisting and tapering and doing all sorts of things, don't necessarily have kind of a very regular profile to them. And the standard tools that we get within Dynamo to work on this don't necessarily do a good job. But let's go ahead and I'm gonna just get rid of all the panels for right now. So we just look at the tower in its pure form here. I'm just gonna filter that, get rid of all those curtain panels. Okay, and we're just going to talk about this form. So forms, as we go through and think about trying to divide the surfaces, can be created either from families, they can be created by in-place masses. In general, families give you a lot more power to give those parameters that we can go through and change. And if we go through and have very regularly shaped sort of surfaces, things work out pretty easily for us. Let me go through for the purpose of just sort of demonstrating this. I'm going to create an in-place mass that has approximately that shape, okay, because it'll be sort of easy to see what I'm up to there. If, for example, I come over here and I say, oh, go to massing, And again, this won't be what you're doing, but it's gonna just demonstrate the problem people are running into. And I'll look at this from the top. No worries. Let me start, I'm just gonna create, kind of the standard sort of a shape we may be used to. Let me just kind of rotate that around. So if this has a very regular shape, let me go ahead and make a form out of that. Okay, that looks good. Pull that up a little bit. What we're doing with Dynamo is, in essence, the same thing that we would do within Revit, where when we want to choose one of the surfaces and say divide that surface up, there's different sort of choices and different approaches to how you might do it. So when things look like this, it's actually not too bad. You can go through and just choose a surface. You can say, let's divide that surface into some sort of UV grid. And it does a pretty good job in terms of what's going on. That's sort of what you would expect to have happen there. Okay. Where this gets a little bit gronky, though, is when that shape starts having a little deformity to it. Okay, when it doesn't actually just sort of have these perfectly rectangular edges that kind of come up from all sides in exactly the same way. So if, for example, I take that surface, which has a little bit of a taper to it, and divide it, you'll see you get something that looks like that. Okay, and in a way, that's almost what we want to have happen. If you think about the panelization, if the panels are coming in a very regular pattern, again, you were going to apply them very regularly, what you'd start thinking about doing is kind of keeping as many of the panels kind of a standard shape as possible. And what you end up with is on the edges, all these little partial panels. Okay, and here, as we're working, dividing this mass here, it does a pretty good job of understanding what it should do. When we talk to Dynamo about doing this, it doesn't do such a good job. What it tends to do is fill in the missing pieces. It'll take kind of the number of grids at the top, the number at the bottom, and give you more points. So when you try to panelize, you get excess panels. Okay, and that's what we're really after trying to not have happen. So let me just finish this mass. Let me kind of show you kind of another mass. This mass is kind of interesting. Because this has flat surfaces, okay, it sort of panelizes it this way. Actually, let me see if I can sort of just distort it and make this example work a little bit differently. Let me edit it back in place again. I'll just remove that panelization. Let me try this. I'm gonna go through and just kind of distort that plane. That plane now is actually had a little bit of curvature to it. Okay, which starts to give us a different sort of behavior. So now, when I divide the surface, notice something very different happens. So if the plane is flat, what happens is it tries to apply a flat pattern and kind of cuts out the excess. If the plane has a little bit of curvature to it, it will break up evenly. And this is kind of weird in the scheme of things. It's kind of like a behavior you have to watch out for in terms of what you're going to have happening as your panelization behavior. So I have never noticed this problem because usually when I'm looking at things, I end up sort of creating these curvaceous surfaces that somehow panelize themselves properly. But for some of the shapes that people are creating up that actually creating for this class where they actually have like perfectly flat planes that are doing the taper, you end up with that weird behavior. So, yes?
So overall, the purpose of this panelization is mainly to draw out like insulation data for a set area, and this is a problem because the areas are of different size? Because this still covers like the shape, kind of. So,
oh, it does. And it really...
Like this one kind of fits, so it seems less of a problem.
Oh, yeah. Now, this one actually does. It's, what'll tend to happen is, if you almost think about trying to apply curtain panels to the outside of the building, mm-hmm. big glass panels and all the mullions, it really kind of depends on what effect you want. And you might want either effect. You might want the lines to go through and follow and divide it and have all the panels change different sizes. You might want all the panels to be as regular as possible and just handle the odd ends as a special case. So you have two different choices. But it's one of those things that if we use the default panelization tool that we've been using, you'll see, you know, it gives you kind of, what is it? it gives you the squared out behavior. So we always have to go through and come up with special cases for how to handle perfectly planar ones, because the default behavior that Dynamo is going to compute isn't necessarily what you want. So what I'll show you today is basically a custom node that goes through and does, it's really the former thing. Let's go back to, if it was like this, and we divide that surface, it'll give you that effect. Okay, which for most standard buildings, if you have big planar surfaces, probably the way it would be handled. If you have all those custom surfaces where everyone's a little bit different and everything's tapering, it's just a more expensive construction detail. But either one of them is perfectly valid. Kind of interesting though. We should play around with this in terms of curves too. I have actually tried that. In the spirit of trying everything, well, I think curves will actually work the way you are going to expect them to work, because they inherently, you know, they don't have flat surfaces to them. It's kind of weird why flat surfaces give you more trouble than non-flat surfaces, but they do. So if, for example, I do this, but I come over here, and where do I want to be? I'll draw another one. Up here somewhere. So. You can think of this as being tapered, but actually tapering with a curvature. Create that form there. Again, if I do the dividing of the surface, okay, it does splay the way you sort of want it. So it's really the only thing that gets you in trouble when things are perfectly flat. Okay, so we have to kind of allow for that. If there's any sort of curvature at all, what it's going to do by default is it's going to break it up in even, okay, and kind of break it out there. But let's see how we can address this. So let me get rid of some of these in-place masses, because those aren't the ones I want to play with. We're gonna play around with this little funny shape in the background. It's actually the twisting tower shape, I think. No, it's the pyramid shape. It's the one we made in class last time. But this is actually pretty similar to what you're working on, Caesar, right?
Yeah.
It's very close to similar. Okay, so let's go ahead and look at it kind of, the standard way. You'll see what the problem is, and then we'll go through and improve on it a little bit. So I'm gonna go to Dynamo, if you can, and we're gonna try to panelize it just the way you would normally be panelizing things, because this is what I, we've sort of learned how to do. We're going to use, it's the node that I never remember the name of. It's like divide surface or something like that. I never remember the proper name of that node. But we'll go out and open. Let's go to the DYN file. We're going to open up a custom node in just a minute. But let's pull this on out. And we'll start up here in the corner. You see, I got my big custom panelization node right here. How about this? Let's go ahead, I'm gonna disconnect that right now. So the first time we run it, we're gonna see the kind of the proper incorrect behavior. Okay, and so in Lunchbox, what was it? It's Divide Surface. That's the one I never remember the name of. Divide Surface UV. Okay, and again, you can do this a number of different ways. If you're gonna kind of make a code block, come up with a different series of parameters and grid them, you get the same problem. It's just basically just shortcutting that. Where what I'm gonna do is I got the element, I'm gonna grab all its faces, then I'm going to grab a specific face, okay? I'm grabbing face 2. Ultimately, you can grab all the different faces if you want to, but I'm just going to grab a specific face, take it over there to the surface, and
what
say...
What is the order of those faces, too? Is it just depending on when you drew them?
Oh, actually, no. It's kind of weird to think about what the logic is. We can look at it in terms of... Yeah, I can never tell like which is the order and which is going to come. So sometimes if you want to get rid of the uppers or the lowers, you have to do something with the surface normals to try and figure out which faces.
Yeah, right before.
Yeah. Now, it's kind of weird because phase zero is actually what I think of the front face, and phase two is the side face, but I think phase three is the bottom face. There's a really weird order to it. Okay, I'm going to take this and divide it into this U and V of 10, so 10 in each direction. Okay, pull that aside, and you'll see what the problem is if I run that. Okay, what I can do, I'm working on that face back over here. But you can see what it's doing is, this is taking the U's and the V's, okay, and it's spreading it as far as it can, and you get all these excess sort of points. And that's the problem we were seeing. So Caesar ran into that, like Filippo ran into that. Yeah, a lot of people were sort of running into that. So if you have kind of flat faces and you try to panelize, this may be happening to you. So what we're going to do is kind of come up with a slightly different scheme. And if it was sort of any sort of curvature, you're probably not going to have this problem. Although what it'll do is, as opposed to imposing a regular grid, it'll have any curvature, it'll compress it. So if you have 10 at the bottom, you'll have 10 at the top. We'll just compress all the way. Okay. We're going to try and go after the strategy if we do keep the rectangular grid, like how we handle all the funny cases where things go off to the side. And to do that, I actually found an example that was pretty good. It was, let me open it up in here. It's all implemented in this custom node, your regular surface dividing the panels. It's based on the notion of basically projecting, taking the whole idea of the grid, laying it down on the floor, then projecting it up as a series of planes to intersect with the surface, and then figuring out where the boundaries of where these planes intersect the surface that you're going with, and then you come up with all these little odd panels around the edges. So let's kind of like replay with it, and we'll sort of take a look. What it actually is based on, let me go ahead and open it over here in terms of looking at the custom node. It's really not much in here, it's just the surfaces to divide and the number of horizontal divisions, and I'm pulling a lot of stuff out here. This was implemented, I actually got the code from, looks like Vikram Subbiah, okay, who posted it, okay, as an example when someone was asking a question like this. But the strategy that he was basically working with involved creating ISO curves along the surface, okay, and the ISO curves basically go through and along the surface, go through and divide a kind of flat lines. Hey, come on in. Flat lines that we can work with that are all at basically the same height. So it's going to go through and subdivide it there. Based on those curves, it's going to figure out what the minimum and maximums are, go through and pull these curves down the plane. That's basically going to draw the lines on the floor, okay? And then it's going to create some surfaces that are just projecting up and then intersect it. So there's a lot of funny little code nuance in here. Just so as you look at this, you'll have some sense of what's going on. This is actually just the code block way of doing it. This is like taking all the code and kind of stringing it together. But for all these things, when we say ISO 1 is curve.iso curve on surface, surface to divide, there's a XY direction, series of points in there. That's the same as a node. There really is that same node. It's just sort of, this is a compact way of doing it that people who program a lot sometimes like to do. But if I went through and said curve, dot ISO curve. Or by ISO curve, excuse me. So this creates a curve on the surface. What it's basically doing is it's going to go through and just go through and put a curve, or in this case a series of curves, okay, at some parameter along the surface. So in our case, what it's going to do is going to take the surface and go all the way from 0 to 1 by the number of divisions, just kind of, and it'll almost be perpendicular to the surface. It's going to basically go through and draw the lines so that it we can sort of subdivide it into the pattern.
So that ISO curve, it like goes from bottom to top and draws horizontal lines and figures out the limits on each side, or I don't quite
understand. Exactly. If you could think about a line going straight up the face from bottom to top.
Okay. And then when it hits a limit, yeah.
And then at each of those different points, 0 to 10, you'll say, okay, here you are at that point. Let me go across the surface and get the same constant height.
Okay.
So it's really kind of a cool function for trying to go through and just put radial lines on top of a surface. So basically, what's happening inside this function is, at the high level, it just sort of basically draws a grid, puts it all down on the floor. The second section is, once we have that grid down on the floor, we create basically planes that'll cut up through the surface. So if you can almost think like one of those cardboard things that separates the bottles when they're in a carton, it's like just the separators. We split the surface with the grid, so we project those up and split it into a whole lot of different little surfaces. And then off all those little surfaces, we figure out how many points are on each of the different surfaces. How many vertices does it have? 3, 4, or 5. Could have some that have 6 if you have the really weird shapes. But based on that, we're just going to return all the different points, the 3 points, the 5 points, the 4 points. We're just going to return all those different values. So what this does, if we go through and apply it, let's go back over to the main part here. Go ahead and I'll reconnect the surface back in. I'll disconnect this one because this is the one we don't want. Rather than actually drawing all the different panels just yet, let's just sort of see the points first. So if I run this, I'll show you what it does. It's gone through and created a series of points where we've taken the surface, projected it up, and many of the points in the center are the same, but the scene we have is weird boundary points. And these boundary points are just done by projecting the grate up. This is the answer to the sloping surface. If I come over here to Dynamo, you might be able to see a little bit more about how this works. If I go to the geometry, expand out. Let me kind of orbit this around a little bit. I guess it's inside, so you don't see it. I'll switch it to the other surface so you'll see it better. Back. Surface there. What I want to show you is actually how the grate actually comes up. But what it's doing is projecting straight upward. Let me try going to a different surface. This is kind of on the surface that faces down. Let me switch this over to the surface that faces up instead. So I believe if I go back over here, surface 0 is one of the ones that faces up as opposed to facing down. I'm wondering why it's not highlighting. Yesterday when I was doing this, I actually got it to, you can actually see the little crate. just inside there. Hmm. Okay. Well, if I'm not going to get it, I'm going to get it in terms of previewing it, but let me, just, I'll draw it, what it's doing. Basically, we have a surface that's coming up on top. What it's doing is it's saying, hey, you basically have extreme points. So what I'm going to do is project all those down to the ground. I'm going to go through and divide this up into a series of crates. Actually, what it does is it actually does the squared out version of it. I should do that. I'll do it this way too. And what it's going to do is just take the planes and just project them up to figure out then really, you know, how they lay out on the surface. So what happens over here at the end is, you know, when you have one of these funny shapes that's a little bit off, it'll come through and project and only get that much of it. So that's how it's basically doing its work. Just kind of projecting up. Oh, the very bad diagram. Oh. Okay, come on back, and here's how it's gonna work for us. So once we go through, and we do go through and panelize, you're gonna see that what we're gonna get is a list of different panels. So I can get all the panel surfaces, or in what I did in this case was inside my custom node, I just did a little Boolean filter masking. So I said, hey, you have 3 points. If you do, you're in this list. You have 4 vertices. If you are, you're in on this list. If you have 5 vertices, you're in on the other list.
Which ones have 5? I don't see any 5 in our diagram, but we have
in this one, I don't think, well,
it's oh, no, it's empty. Okay, yeah, good.
Actually, it's empty here. And if you go back to, I think it's surface 3, that'll have that has 5.
Okay,
where it just falls off around the edges. So what you do with this is you basically need to basically take those different lists and map them. So, or I'll take those 4 points and apply an adaptive component that has 4 points to it. But let me show you, we have a couple of other panels, because if you have a little 3-point panel, and you want to address it, like here's the 4-pointers. Let's let that run. Can you spot the 3-pointers? They're sort of, they're hanging around on the edges, looking a little raw right there. So we need a 3-point panel, and we actually created one of those. So feel free to use this if you want to. Out there in the rectangular seamless panels, there's a rectangular seamless 3-point. If you go through and edit it, you'll see it looks an awful lot like the 4-point version, only it only has 3 different vertices as opposed to 4. And in the same sense, I had to create a 5-point panel. Okay, that has a certain number of points down here. We extruded out to a length. So the 5-point panel, that's a little messier looking, but let's take a look at that. Come back over here, let's go to the 5-point panel. So for your panelization, if you get yourself into the situation where this is happening and you need a 3-point panel or you need a 5-point panel, please borrow these. Just go ahead and use them. Take this node in terms of sort of subdividing what you need to. But it's basically gonna just break you down into 3 different categories, and we panelize each of the different categories based on what you need. So everyone who has got a flat taper, it'll sort of happen too. Okay, so feel free to go through and use those. Okay, that's it in terms of the panelization stuff. I think I come back in and I connect. Let me go back over to, I think it was surface 3, which had the 5-pointer. It says the current Dynamo document, or the current Revit document, is not the appropriate one. That's true. And you just shift it back to the project. Okay, so as you're going and thinking about your project, this is really, again, something that everyone has to do. If you're in for 4 units and you do decide on what the shape that you think is kind of a good shape, the idea is you could panelize it and like put some visual feedback on that. So yeah, in general, you don't want to be panelizing on every iteration because really we're just using the panelization as an illustration of what the final form is. Yeah, we're not really doing it necessarily as part of our analysis. But you can sort of see here, we have, here's these 5-point panels that are a little bit strange. This one here actually is a little interesting here. 1, 2, 3, 4, might actually be 6 points on that one there. Either that or there's a 3 and a 4 right there, either the 5 and a 3 right next to each other. This is what's happening right there. So just come through and reconnect the 3s, reconnect the 5s. But again, save that. That's the very tail end of your process after you've already sort of found something you like. That little 5-pointers are showing up in white because they're not quite the right thickness.
Okay. How can we join them all together?
What's that?
How can you join them all together?
Oh, that was really, if I was going to take the entire list of panels and do override color and view or something like that, I could then evaluate them based on the directness or whatever you want to do to kind of colorize them. So that's the only reason at the tail end. Okay, great. Let's go ahead. Any questions about that? That's just kind of this really weird little thing that I wasn't really kind of planning on, but okay, if you have flat tapers, this is how you have to deal with it. So. That's where that came from. The other thing I wanted to look at, though, with you is the whole energy node and how we can think about the energy node, because the energy node is one that is giving some people troubles just because it takes a while to run. Okay? So because it takes a while to run, you may want to sort of break it down into 2 different nodes, okay, because that might actually help you out. So let's go ahead and for that one, I'm going to go back over to the example that's in the same folder. It's the 18.1 example. At least the code from the 18.1. And, well, actually even here, I can just even bring this energy, well, I'll do the proper thing that links it all together and then kind of because we do it anywhere we want to. Okay, so I could select the model element and change whatever it is I want to do here. I'm not going to run it right now. Which maybe I will. Select this. Come over here. Got that. Okay, what do I have on this? Is a variant. Do I have tower height? Top width, I do have tower height. Okay, great. Tower height. So the idea is we can go through and flex this thing, get the area, whatever we need to pull out of this. But when I edit the custom node, one of the nodes that we're sort of playing around with is an energy analysis node. We didn't talk about it much last time, but let's talk about it now. The idea is that we can go through and take our updated element, because we always want to get the updated element. Okay. And then analyze the energy model. Now, I played around with this a little bit. What I wanted to actually do is go through and make sure that what every time we went through and did these analyses, okay, that we always had the updated version of the model, and that we had a case string which is unique, so that if we go through and put a lot of GBXML tiles out there, they could all have unique names. Otherwise, they'll write on top of each other, and they'll get a little bit confused about which one you're working with. So I have this node, but in terms of feeding things into it, there's a couple things I want to do. One is I want to feed in the updated version of the mass, not the original mass. So that's why I put that there as an input. So I'm going to grab the transaction ended updated version of the mass. All right, pull that down. Now, for the case string, that can be sort of an interesting thing. Right now, I just pulled in, since I was only varying a single thing, the input parameter value, that was one of them. If you're feeding in pairs, like Caesar's feeding in pairs of values, what you may need to do is go through and kind of take whatever the value is in here and kind of pull it apart and make a string out of it, just so it can be unique. So for example, for me, I'm going from 200 to 250. So my cases are going to be case 200, case 210, case 220. If you're varying both the height and the width, you might want 220-50, 220-60, 220, you need something to make them unique so you can kind of spot them. So watch out for that in terms of this case ID. That's just a string, so do whatever you need to go ahead and do that. But then what we want to do is as follows. There's this whole GBXML project title string. Go through and, every time you start running this, okay, it is probably good to go through and keep on changing this string over here to somehow be something that's new, fresh, current to indicate what it is you're doing right now. If you keep on writing it to the same project, it gets confused. You have a whole bunch of run IDs all under the same project, so it may just get a little bit confusing. Yeah, you could even put some sort of date and time stamp in here, make a string out of that if you want to. When Rami and I were playing around with this yesterday, we sort of just had a problem that it just kept on writing things over and over again to the same one, and then it sort of got confused, in terms of what you were trying to do. So I will go through and just for my first run here, say 19A. Okay, now let's look at this node, the conceptual mass energy analysis node. This node, for the most part, should work for you. It does a pretty good job of taking the mass family, it takes the product title string, it takes the kind of unique case string, and makes a directory name out of it, so all the GBXML files are looking good. Most people have had pretty good luck with working with this. It all comes on down. Here's what you want to watch out for. You want to make sure that it goes through and it writes out some GBXML files. Okay, so it's going to take your mass family, it's going to go through and break it up into all these different floor levels, okay, and then write out a GBXML file. So the first step of it is it writing out the GBXML file? If you're debugging, a really good thing to do as a starting point, let me even here, I'll do this over here. Let me kind of run it once just so you can sort of get the idea of what it's up to. Come back over here. I'm going to go 100 to 120 by 10. Okay, so three values. That's not so bad. Again, if you're going to fail, fail quickly, fail on a small number. You don't need to sort of fail a whole lot of times to do that.
I thought it was go big or go home.
But well, that sounds like a much better way. But that could take a long time. So you might be going home as you're waiting because it just takes a long time. Funny how you get these conflicting pieces of advice. Okay, so we'll go through. Let me just go ahead and run this. And actually, I'm going to separate it a little bit. Even here. I'm going to break this right now between the part where we run the energy analysis and we get the analysis results. Because here's where we actually typically have a problem. It's going to fail in one of two places. Either it's not going to write the XML file, okay, and we'll check that. We can see whether it wrote the XML file. The other thing we want to check is, generally it does a pretty good job of uploading XML files. This part is really upload and start the analysis. This part is get the analysis results. And this is where it gets a little bit grumpy sometimes, in that it's supposed to basically wait, because this is true, for the server to be done. Okay, but it doesn't always do that. So it gets past this point, and it didn't wait. I think it's because of the way the coding is working with the server. You'll get nulls, because it's going to read the values before the values have actually been computed. Okay. So, we're going to recommend a different strategy right here. Another one, just so Jordan had this experience right here about enabling the parametric runs. In general, that should be left to false. That'll just do a single run for every case. If you turn on enable parametric runs, which we'd have to sort of do with a Boolean, what that does is then it runs like 60 different variations on every case of different R values, different orientations, different window to wall ratios, all sorts of stuff. And you don't want to do that, or you don't need to do that for what we're doing. Okay, so what I'm going to recommend is sever right there. Okay, and then what I'm going to suggest doing is, as opposed to pulling out the energy results here, what we can do is just basically send out the run ID. Now, the advantage of sending out the run ID is, hey, the run ID is a valid way of referring to the run out of the energy analysis results. So you can do this in two steps. If you want to send everything to the cloud, let it run, get the run IDs, okay, we'll come back later, and based on the run IDs, we'll run the second half of the script. So we can do that in a whole separate Dynamo node. You don't have to kind of keep it together, because if you have the run IDs and we write them out to an Excel file, we put them somewhere where we can find them later, we can go back and basically feed this a list of run IDs and then get the energy analysis results for those run IDs. Okay, so that's, I think, probably the most successful way we've seen people looking at it. So I'm going to take this over here and say that, you know, actually, I'll even just take that out over there. This is going to say the energy run IDs. And pop that right here. I'll just get rid of that one for right now. So if I do that, what's going to happen is back over here, where I'm gathering that data, I'm just going to get a bunch of energy run IDs, not the actual EUI number or the cumulative life cycle cost, whatever it is. But I'm going to go through and add that in as my final thing to write out. And again, what is it? It's basically a placeholder. It's a placeholder for some analysis results you're going to download when the things are done downloading. So it's OK to separate those things. But let's just kind of run this through and sort of see what that looks like. So I got my conceptual energy mass down there. Oh, do I want to do the total cost stuff? I can do that. That's not so bad. OK, let's go ahead and run this so far. If I come back over here, well, let's just run it. Looking good. Come back over here. Let us go through and run this thing. Results data. Okay. Input parameter. Looking good. Let's run it. As it's running, you're going to notice it's going to do some regenerating in the background. One of the slowest things about this whole operation, as soon as we do the energy analysis, is for every different iteration, it's going to redo the energy model. So if you have 50 floors, that's a lot of different little zones that it generates. So that's why it slows down so much. As you can see, it's, I should have like pulled this out of the way so you can see. It's doing a lot of generating back in the background. Hopefully there's only three cases here. What should happen for each of those cases, though, is, and this is how you can sort of snoop on it. If you go back out to, let's see where to go. Somewhere on my desktop. I have left my folder. There's the 100 case right there. Actually, I didn't fix it. I wanted to put the thing back in there. You see, so that's the tower height 100 case. It wrote it out on 531. It's going to write out the 110 and the 120 case here in just a second. So I'm snooping. I can sort of tell that it's doing what it's supposed to be doing. Yeah, it's putting this in whatever folder we sort of gave it as a path. In my case, I just gave it the path just for the desktop because I sort of messed it up.
I don't think mine's right.
Hmm?
I don't think mine's right.
You know you're in?
I don't think they're ready.
Oh, no?
No.
Mm-hmm. What do you mean?
It is because folders are not popping up.
Oh, not on yours?
No.
Hmm. Did you go through and let's just check out your path and sort of see what's going on?
Yeah.
Let's look at the path because I suggested last time we had the kind of slash into the path.
Yeah, I put that.
Nothing
slash
yet?
Right, not the other slash.
Yeah, it's the backslash.
Yes, it's right.
Okay, we'll take a look at it. There's just something going on there. Okay, so you'll see what's going on is it created these three different cases for me. It put them on my desktop. That's just because I was a little sloppy in my program. Let me go back and fix that over here. If I come back over here, you'll actually sort of see, couldn't run the analysis. Interesting.
Yeah.
Let's see what's going on here. Okay, a couple different things. We'll go back into, not that one, my little report some data.
Well, never mind. Just,
did you do
it? It just wasn't where I was expecting it.
Okay, so a couple things to watch out for in here, just as we're debugging. There was the directory string. You can sort of see that I actually didn't actually go through and put, I wanted to go through and put in like one more slash, right in there. Because what I wanted to do is basically put them inside a directory. So the way to do that would put a slash right there. That would actually put all the test cases in a directory. But as we go through and take a look at what worked, you'll see, did it run the export zones to GBXML? Oh, actually, so here I am, I should have put a watch on it. Yeah, the answer is yes, it did go through and do something successfully there. In terms of next, did it go through and upload it? And I think it did, okay. But again, I should put some watches in here. The report field is just basically a report of whether it was successful or not. Okay, but let's go back and kind of see at the high level what it came out of this. List. Could not run the analysis. Looks like I'm a little messed up in terms of my list over here. I got those two. Could not run the analysis and null right there. That's looking a little bit strange. That's my square footage, that's my cost. In terms of what's going on here, it looks like the report's coming out funny. Well, could not run the analysis. Let's see what's going on. This one actually did give you a run ID right there. It's 728450. Okay, so it looks like the first one did, the second one didn't run. Let's go and take a look and see if we figure out why. If I come on over to Green Building Studio, actually it's gbs.autos.com. We can take a look. Remember, Dynamo is always just automating whatever you can do manually, so if it's not working manually, it's not working for again, Dynamo. So let's see what's going on here. Come on, you. Okay, so here's at least one run came through. Here's the 100 test case. You actually see it actually did get an energy use intensity in terms of what's going on. That's looking pretty good. That's happening in terms of the 110 and the 120 in terms of why it's not here yet. Not sure. We don't see anything there in terms of an error. Let's back over here. See if we can figure this out. We got this over here. Run the analysis. The path should be good. Execute, timeout. Well, we're just gonna have to wait and basically see what's going on with the report, because the That's basically giving us the problem right now. Instead of giving us the run IDs, it's telling us that it couldn't run the report. But I don't know. Let's see if we can make some sense out of that. Try us again. I'll just do two of them this time. As we look at the results, if these run IDs are coming back, it looks like it's giving me a list over here, so I might need to flatten that out a little bit.
Yeah.
Or just hit the first one. Because the list of the run IDs would be if you did the whole bunch of parametric runs, it would give you a whole bunch of different run IDs. We're only really going to go through and run one. So it's hard to get the first one out of that list. But I'm not quite sure why the other two didn't run. See if we can get any sort of answer to that. So if I go over to Snooping Land, it should be inside this folder. There's test case 100. Let's see if 110 comes through here. Looks like 110 just got written up. So that part's looking good. Looks like it just got compressed. That part's looking pretty good. Let's go complete it. Over here, it still looks pretty good. Here we got the list there. List could not run the analysis. It says it's null. That's a little bit strange. Try to run the analysis for this file again. Okay. Let's go back and sort of see if we can figure out anything about what might be causing this trouble. Here it's telling me that it couldn't upload the GBXML file, test case 110.xml. Set this timeout longer and try to run again. Okay, so it could be, it's giving you a little information there about what the problem is. Maybe it didn't upload it quickly enough. We know that at least in terms of what should have come there. The GBXML file was created. GBXML file name is there. That's the path. That looks like it's okay. So the next thing I would do is just try to increase the timeout. The timeout currently is set to 300,000. I don't know if that's 300 seconds, but I would try, let's go ahead and give it like a million, just to be on the really safe side. Correct. 300,000. But as you go through and try to debug, you're seeing that the file's there. That's okay. It definitely generated the file. For some reason, it just couldn't upload it. And if it says test case 110.xml, let's make sure it actually called the same thing over here. Test case 110.xml. Okay, looking pretty good. So I'm going to guess it's a timing thing. But let's talk about what the net of all this is. If we do get this to run, you'll see that back over here, we have, right in there. A run ID. Okay. So what we're going to think about doing is for all your different runs, going through and keeping some sort of maybe an Excel spreadsheet or CSV, whatever it is, just something to kind of tally what's going on. So we can write these values out. Let me go ahead and just kind of flatten that one there because that's just bothering me right now.
You went dark momentarily. And also, what does the run ID exactly mean?
I'll show you. That's actually good.
Because then we plug it back in and then we get all of the values out. So it encapsulates all of the data going into
it's
the
basically,
analysis.
I'll show you. It is Let me get the index. It actually worked. It would work to flatten this too. I only want to get one. If there happened to be more than one. Okay, so the idea is, let's save that away. It gives us an ID number, the 72043 or something like that. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna write this out to an Excel file. So I can say Excel, write to file. Okay, great, that's gonna be the data that's going out. The start row and column could be 0 and 0. The sheet name could be whatever we wanna call it. It's gonna be my building metrics. Okay, building metrics, 0, 0. For the file path, this is again that one where you get to sort of write it wherever you want it. I'll remove that one. Okay, so this is going to put it on the desktop here. Oh, it's going to be my building metrics results. .xls. So that would write out the file. But the ever so important question is, what does that number actually do for you, that 720453? Let me go over to Green Building Studio and show you where it is. If you are over in Green Building Studio, you'll say, hey, okay, here's this test case. For this test case, which got run, there's all sorts of data out here. There's the annual energy cost, the life cycle cost, the CO2 emissions, all this data. All this data has been computed for that test case. Okay. And we can get to any of that data. And how we do it is we use the number. If you were going to go through and export this, oh, where can I find it in here? Oh, it's interesting. A new one just came through. Okay, so if I take this one right here and I say I want to export it, you'll see that there's these different run files, so 720 and 450 and 453. So this is the latest one. This data is the same because it's the same basic number. Okay, so if I went through and fed it a whole list of data values here, I'd be able to go through and get these numbers. So let's let that work away for just a second and we'll show you how that works. Looks like it's doing pretty good right now. Is it still working in the background? Hopefully a 110 is going to come in there too. What you're going to do is, after you're all done, okay, and this thing's running in the background, is, let's go back over to here. Okay. We basically want a function which is going to go through and read some stuff, pull out those values, and get us that the information we want. So what I'm going to do is basically set up a whole new node. Okay, it's going to look like this. We're going to say, hey, let's go ahead and read an Excel file. File path and file from path. So we're gonna basically gonna go through and give it a file. Give it a file path over here. Let's go out and read that thing. Where did I put it? I put it on my desktop, didn't I? Oh, I put it on, I'm in the good place. Actually, I put that in the desktop on the, it's interesting, on the Mac side. It's not a very good place for me to put that thing. Home. See if I can read it. Put it out there. Or did I not save it? Again, I guess I haven't saved it yet. I'll put it in downloads. Find when I'm reading these files, I will tend to go through and just really make the names as simple as possible because I don't sort of trust the parsing of the spaces and stuff like that. So I'll go back over there to downloads. So I'm going to read that. I'm going to get that data out of there. It's reading the Excel data file right now. In terms of the data file, it still wants a sheet name. Let's go see and get the sheet name. It's CSV, that's a nice looking name. CSV, session 19A. Watch on this thing. Basically, what we're going to try and do is just read those values. So what's happening here is the run IDs that I want, that's really, they're at the top of, basically every list of the first item right there. What I might want to do is just, given the way this is organized, is just do a little list transposing of it so I can get the columns instead. Okay, now at least flip the order around. So I can get the kind of columns in there. You'll see that the very first column now is basically run ID with the two different run IDs in it. So what I can do is basically just get the first item. That will basically get the first column. And then you're basically going to get a list of the different run items, or the run numbers. That list is very, very close, except it still has one last thing up top. It has this little run ID, so I want to get rid of the first item, because that's just really the header. Okay, so the very last thing will be list remove item at index. Okay, so all of this so far has really just been about, can you go back and read kind of things back off the top? Okay, and we can. And you get all done with this, and you basically have those different run IDs. Okay, so the next question becomes, okay, great. If we have the different run IDs, can we go out and get the data results that are associated with them? And you can, and that's really this, that latter part of the function. It's that one that we were looking at, oh, at the tail end originally. It's over here. It's basically where you say, get the analysis results. Or is it under here? Hang on. Run errand, yeah, it's up here, it's somewhere. Get this, get this, get run IDs. That's the run IDs. Load analysis results. Huh. So, if we go through and we take this and we say, let's feed in the different list of run IDs, it basically goes back and gives us the run results. So, what is it doing? It's going back out to Green Building Studio, and based on the run IDs we're feeding it, it's going back and loading in those results. So, let's put a couple more watches in here just so you can sort of see how this all is playing out. So if I put the watch here, you'll see there's the list of the run IDs. If I put another watch down here, you'll see there's all sorts of information about the building location and all that kind of stuff, all that stuff that just is been floating around inside the Green Building Studio. But the results themselves are also an object. The weird thing about the results, though, is as an object, they're sort of a compound object that has a lot of stuff in the data structure. So we need to go just one step further in terms of being able to reuse those results. And what you do is as follows. You say, hey, okay, I got some energy results. Let's go ahead and get, for example, what do I want to get? Well, sort of the energy carbon cost summary is one thing we can pull out of there. So if you pull those out of the results, what's going to do is go back and, from the server, download the annual energy cost, the life cycle cost, the annual CO2 emissions, all that information down there. So what is it doing? It's really just pulling the same information that's in the Green Building Studio interface. It's just giving it to you over here. So you can pull any of these numbers. And as you search for sort of a single metric to talk about your energy use, you could go ahead and compare annual energy cost. If you looked at life cycle energy cost, then you have the differences amplified by 30 years worth of data, so the differences become kind of even stronger in terms of how you're evaluating them. Okay, it's all the same data. It's just really how you looked at it. Some people prefer to look at it in terms of like the EUI. Where is that here? This is the energy carbon cost. Let me go to the other one that actually gives you EUI. That's another one in here. Where is it? It's not the lead potential. Energy model files. Carbon electric power. Life cycle cost. There's EUI, and that's back over there. Get lead potential, get project lists. That's just the CO2 and the net equivalents. Annual energy, life cycle cost. I'm trying to think about where the one is that has actually the EUI. It's one of them in here. Electric power sources, energy carbon, energy model, lead potential. I'm going to think of where it is because it's kind of hanging around in here. Oh, is it in the build? Oh, hang on. Is it back over here? Let me do this. I'm going to watch the building summary. Number of people, heating, cooling. That's just that. Oh, I'm going to find the EUI. It's buried alive in one of these numbers. It's not that. It's not the carbon neutral. It's like I'm missing a node. I know I'm missing a node in here. I'll figure out where it is just a second. Whatever. It's like you go through and choose which of these different certified ones you want to go through and use as your metric. Yeah, she bothers me that I don't see the UI. I know it's carried alive or something, but I'm just not seeing it right now because I'm looking at the board. Okay, enough of all that. That's really kind of the big idea is really you can separate things, so don't be afraid to separate them because it's perfectly cool to have run ideas as placeholders for waiting for things to continue to run in the background. Because in theory, it will keep on running in the background, so you will get some more data. So, oops, let's go back over here. Still got the 100. It's interesting. Oh, let me refresh this. I don't see the 110 case. So I'm really kind of wondering what's going on there, although I sort of stopped it. You know, what you can do, it's always a matter of just sort of debugging as best you can. Yeah, the same system, because it should be doing, there, the EUI is right there, and it's like 48. But it should be able to do everything, you know, just the same. So if it's writing out the 110 and it's just not working for some reason, go through and try this. And again, just try doing it manually. You'll often sort of find out what the problem is when you go through and try to do things manually. Okay, so here's my project. Here's what we have so far. You could always try upload a GBXML file and just see what happens if you go ahead and grab it. Okay, we've got the 120 case. So I'm not sure if it stopped just because I interrupted things. But don't be afraid to sort of manually run it through to see. I mean, it didn't seem like it took that all that long to go through and upload. Even for your purposes, even if you're having trouble getting Dynamo to do the uploading, don't be afraid to go ahead and just kind of, you know, take the GBXML files that have been generated and upload them manually in terms of getting the run ID. Well, that's interesting.
Is that 110 caching itself?
That's actually a good question. I'm not really sure what it's doing here. Okay, 110 is there. Did I do 110 twice? There's 110, it's doing its thing. Let me try and make sure if I got 120. I thought I did a separate one. Interesting that it's being smart enough to tell me what's going on. No, I have a duplicated GBXML, so I gotta think about what's going on in my logic about why the 120 case is the same as the 110 case here. Not checking. Looks like it's actually all the same file. That's sort of interesting in terms of why that's all the same file. Maybe that's what the problem is that we're having, is that it's continuing to kind of just like write back on top of each other. The same thing. But it should be doing it for the uploaded mass. I'm just gonna think about that. If it's really not writing out a different file, if it's actually writing out the same exact file, that's a little odd. So that would be back in our logic. So let me think about what's going on over there. We'll come back over here. And we go back over to It's funny, that error message that we just saw, that is definitely, that's the type of thing that gets you in trouble in terms of why it's not doing it. So that's satisfying in that sense that we're actually sort of seeing something why it wouldn't work. In terms of why it's not actually doing that, here we are. Let me come back over here. I want to make sure I'm getting the updated mass, mass family instances. It should be getting the transacted one. I don't know, I'll do a little debugging to figure out what's going on. There's something going on a little bit strange in terms of generating what's happening here. But if we can't get this to work nicely for you, again, just for each of the different cases, just go ahead and export it manually. And like we read it in that way too. Although, I think this should be working, but I don't want to come debug this all right now. We're going to look at what's happening and send something out to you with an update there. What I'd rather do is actually look at your towers. Because you have some pretty groovy looking towers in here. So let me think about the way to do this. Like, I know who has towers? Caesar's got a tower, Jenna's got a tower. Dana, you got a tower?
Yeah.
Excellent. Wouldn't you be willing to share?
Sure.
Okay, let's go ahead and see if we can actually put them up somewhere and just kind of take a look at them. Walk through and tell us your theory of your tower.
Jordan's got a good backstory too. Yeah.
Well, exactly. Okay, how about this? Can you guys upload things into the file folder on Canvas? Can you put them in there? Like, have you ever tried uploading? You only download.
I can upload to like my personal like turn-in file and see it.
Oh, in the assignment part?
Yeah.
You can, I'm trying to think of that. How about, what else could we do? We could put them in the A360, in your A360 folders.
Sure.
How about that? Go through and, like, if you can, put your like Revit model in your A360 folder, and we'll just go ahead and kind of bring them up and kind of take a look at them. So again, what I'm thinking about is on Stanford Revit, but a360.com. Just go ahead and, if you can, put them out there. Oh, in the 120C. Just drop it in there somewhere. And again, this isn't your final one, but I just sort of want to share what you're all working on. So how about that? And I'll come back over here. Actually, maybe I can do this without even going out there. If I can get to my A360 folder from here.
Do you need the project file?
Yeah, get the project.
Will it automatically upload the mass and the profile?
If it's inside the project, it'll come with it.
Okay.
Spring. We might actually, there are no A360, See, it's gonna fight with me that way, that's okay. I'm trying to be all clever. It never works for me. Okay, let's come out here. Okay, who's my first lucky victim? Volunteers? Anyone? Jenneri, were you volunteering?
It's not up there.
No? Did you? Let's see what we got over here. Proud assignment 5? I hear a volunteer. Okay, it's out there? Okay, proud assignment 5. Let's take a look at this. If you send the family, we can upload that too, either way.
Oh, so you pushed it. Yeah.
All will say continue. Well, check this out. Okay, Dr. Pratt, would you like to come up and like walk us around a little bit and show us what you have?
Pretty simple.
Well, there's a mouse over there.
All right. So what I was thinking was that Stanford graduate housing needs more residential area. Some people would rather live in the city, down here in the bubble. So they hired me and my team to design some high-rise residential downtown San Francisco. And the initial proposals were there would be a Block S for Stanford, and then a Block J for Jordan. No, not me. Our first president, like as in the Jordan Quad.
See?
So let's see, we got this guy right here. You can edit the base height, base width. So that would be like, the way I designed it was if it would keep its proportions. So that's the only input parameter on the top height. The bottom one likewise the same thing. So it can grow or shrink whichever one you want, and then it also has a twist. So let's see if I can show that. So if you go, for instance, change this top height to 100, it should make the top fatter.
Yeah, it's a working.
It'll take a little time here. Come on, baby. All right, so we got a fat J now. And then it also has a twist, just kind of the same way we did in class. And you can also change the tower height as well.
Okay.
And then it's a twist. So it's at a 45 degree twist right now. You can also give it like, let's say, a 5 degree twist.
And right at the beginning of class, you asked a really good question. And it's this whole notion of, we should share it with everyone. You know, can you sort of normalize it so that no matter what the height is or whatever the width is, you always sort of stay within the target area? And if anyone wants to play that game, you don't have to. You can sort of play with this manually, but if you want to do that in a more automatic way, that's an example of you would do a while loop, a list map at the high level, but then you'd have a while loop inside of the list map to sort of say that for a specific height, you adjust some other parameter to the range to give you the target amount of square footage.
That might take a while though, because the way you would do that was you'd be using Revit as the calculator.
Yes.
So you'd have to like, the way I'm thinking is to start at some minimum value that you think might be acceptable, and then jump it up until you hit an acceptable range. But that might take a while.
Oh, it would. No, exactly, which is exactly why
it's
that's a hard way to do it.
It's almost better to just give it a range that you know.
Yeah.
Like say, okay, I'm going to, you know what I mean, like very few parameters.
Oh, definitely. It's, you know, to your point, I think, if you do know about where you are and you can go with a narrow range, it's just much more efficient. There's no reason to have it just doing a lot of computations for something that you know is just invalid.
All right, so that's what I got. I got an S.
Super.
S also, but didn't upload it.
Thank you. Okay, thank you for sharing.
For you. Are you looking to panelize it for any reason?
Yeah, I think so at the end.
To
but
do
only,
ins-
the, only the optimized
or?
One. No,
or
I think I would do the insulation.
By surface?
Before I panelized it, by those surface, maybe by those quads.
Okay.
I don't know.
Yeah, now even for the insulation, you can do it just based on the surfaces themselves.
Yeah,
so you
I probably will do it on the whole surfaces rather than, because there's a lot of surfaces here, I probably won't panelize them until like the optimized
point.
Okay. That's kind of my intent for the assignment. Just go ahead and as sort of a big, gross, blocky mass as long as you can, and really save the panel version for the last. There's an incremental difference, but it's pretty small. Okay. Mr. Filippo, can we share yours?
Oh yeah, I think I did.
Okay, is it out there? Because I think you have another really interesting one. Hang on. Let's see if I can close some of this stuff. Okay, popping out over here. Where did you go, Mr. Rinale? There you are. Over here?
Yeah. Looks like it's that one.
Well, actually, I'm opening it that way. I just want to download you. get a couple more in here, more just for inspiration, so you can sort of see what they're like. Hang on. Is it coming? There we go.
Okay. It's complaining a little bit.
Okay, you can say continue to open the file.
Yeah, so nothing too fancy here. This is
nothing too
fancy.
Yeah.
Did this last night.
I was trying to copy that tower. I think it looks really cool. It's also interesting how it's cantilevered. So I don't know if you can see it from here, but my advisor actually worked on this, and he said it was crazy to build it because, you know, it has a huge overturning moment. So I thought it was a pretty interesting structure, and it looks kind of funny here, but I tried running the energy analysis on it, so it's not finalized or anything yet. It thinks there are a few
nodes
going like that.
That's the conceptual conceptual energy. It's zoning it for you, so it's kind of breaking off the different corners.
Okay, and in terms of parameters, so I'm varying basically the height of the whole tower, then the height of the top story
Go under massing and sight. I'll tell you how to turn that off. Go to massing and sight on in the ribbon. Way up the top. Which is basically is showing the zones, and the zones are what's slowing you down. Right? So go here, and on this thing that says show mass by view settings, pull down there and say just form and floors.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay, that's a little bit closer to what you want. At least it's hiding the zones.
Yeah, I don't think you can see the actual parameters here, but I'm varying the length of the face and the width of the tower itself, and also the inclination. So I'm getting some pretty interesting variations.
The inclination of what surface? Which one is tilted?
The tower, basically. So.
Oh, the tower is in the top part, tilted down or so?
Yeah, this inclination right here, basically.
Okay.
And then this height right there, and the height between the bottom of this floor and the top of this floor here.
Cool.
As I said, it's not too complicated.
Can you open up your file with the reference lines?
Yeah.
How did you make it with pushing and pulling, or a lot of reference lines?
I lofted it, actually. So
you
I had four different levels, and then I just drew.
Yeah, 1, 2, and then the 3 and 4.
Yes.
Right,
yeah.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, I'll show you the family real quick.
Okay, so a lot of those are. Do you have measurements?
Yeah, so it's basically one floor, one level.
There you are. Can you put it back in inside the folder inside that? It's a separate sort of project right now. Okay. And Caesar, it looks like you're at the upper level too. Can you put it inside the Spring 220 C1?
Yeah.
Miss Diana, do you got something for us?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go take a look. Okay, so I'm going to go back into, put it back over here. Star Tower. star of power. Okay, let's go around. Let's see.
Where do you envision this being located?
I mean,
isn't
just where I would
have
to.
Oh, well, yeah. 200 miles up street.
But if you had your choice, you might come up with a more glamorous location. Let's see what we got here. See what's going on. I need to I need to show that. I think I got it now. Oh wow. Please come take us on a tour.
Oh, it's just stars with twins.
Yeah.
Like four people.
Okay, let's take a look.
It's close to 180. That's a sharp shot. We know it breaks that.
It kind of looks like the end of, like, what are those things you throw, like,
the,
at the...
The shuriken?
At the target things?
Oh, a dart.
A dart.
It's kind of like the edge of a dart. Yeah,
yeah.
Twisted. Yeah.
That's
yeah.
very dramatic. It kind of reminds me of the Shard in London. It's sort of
yeah,
all these sharp edges. People would like be up touching all the time. That's like
protection.
You have a you have very good daylighting throughout.
Yeah,
yeah.
Exactly.
But I wonder what your resale value.
I'm a little scared about my core.
So you can you change the size of the top versus the bottom like this? This
yeah,
okay.
I can.
Because right now this isn't selling us as well because the the most expensive floors are on top. Right?
Yeah,
yeah.
But you can change.
So we
like,
can change these things up here.
Yeah, you can make it larger. You can also change like the point, make it like the part that goes inwards on both sides.
Oh, cool. Okay. And make that wider or thinner?
Yeah, like you
okay.
can make it fat.
Oh,
I think it
cool.
can turn into like a square.
Oh yeah, if it gets wide enough,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Cool. Let me come back over. Where'd they go? I went in the background. So we can change all these parameters to these
mm-hmm.
So you basically have a profile bottom, profile top, and rotating around.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. This is the one where, yeah. Oh, it'll be, you know, depending on the height and those parameters, you can really get all sorts of different floor areas,
yeah.
depending on what you want to do. But a very cool shape. Okay, you up there now, Miss Jenna?
Yeah.
Okay, let's see if we can get to yours. We'll put it down there now. Okay. There you are. Yeah, you were sort of familiar with this site because you've done things here in the past.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's see. Is it opening? I think it's opening in the background there.
So instead of doing one form and changing it a lot, I decided to do 10 different forms just because I really like playing with masses.
Let's see if it's doing it. I think it's still just there. It is. Okay, so you just continue and you'll be fine. It's thinking, we might have to under masking insight. Yeah, turn that on so it says the building forms and floors. Beautiful. Now try and give it a Z. Oh, it's going.
There we go. Come back.
How about ZF? A little zoom to fit. Check that out.
So for all of these, I basically just started with two or three shapes on different planes, whether it was like the first floor and the top floor, and then would create a mass from them. And then from there, I would just kind of push and pull everything. Ah, going the wrong way.
No, ZF again.
Yeah.
That's quickie.
Okay. So a lot of them started out as really simple forms, and then I just started pushing and pulling things. So. Like this one just started, I would do the outline of the top or the bottom of it, and then would drag the points to change it. And then for the more organic ones, those ones I made different spines, kind of freeform, and then would, the idea was just connecting different shapes as they went up, and then would push and pull that. And then this one on the end here, first I created a mass form, and then I created a void form, and so it kind of cut it out in the middle. So that was fun, and then this one got some twisting action going on. Instead of telling it to twist, I would just draw it differently, so when it connected, it would automatically twist that way. There's my manual. Okay, I don't know where it went. There it is. Yeah.
Very good.
That's what I did.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else want to volunteer? Arrows? Okay, let's go ahead and like wrap her up. So, in terms of how we'll sort of finish this all up, so thank you for sharing the forms we're working on today, what we want to do. Actually, Susan, you didn't want to show yours?
I can show mine. Like,
okay, let's do it.
It's a variation on the pyramid mask.
Here. Let's go ahead and open it up, and then I'll just talk as you're opening here. Okay, because I remember, yeah, we had your pictures up. Okay, so... over here, Caesar. There you are. Okay, it looks like it's opening. Okay, as that's opening, let me comment on what we'll do. Because most of you have really good looking forms here. We're going to keep on going through and computing as many of the metrics as we can. Yeah, you may not be able to get to all the metrics. Different things break along the way. Yeah. Ultimately, what you want to do is you want to go out and recommend your three favorite forms, and maybe even specifically the one you like the best, and basically share that with us. And how I'm going to recommend sharing it is this. We're going to basically put out there like a Google Docs spreadsheet that has a bunch of columns in it for each of the different metrics. And if you could go ahead and just report, you know, give each of your different towers your favorite for your name. It could just be A, B, you know, Pratt A, B, and C, whatever it is. Okay, put them out there, kind of report the metric values that you have. Maybe even give us a little screenshot kind of each of them, just something so we can sort of see them all. Because at the end, you want to be able to have a big list for the whole class of like all the different forms out there and really compare like all the different metrics and how different people came up. Okay, but I'll send out a little note about that and how we're going to do that. So it'll, you'll get something, an invitation, like a Google Docs spreadsheet to put those in. Okay, Mr. Caesar, go ahead and like show us yours.
Yeah, it was just like the same as the pyramid mask, but just put a like change the top of the tower. It just has taper on one side right here.
My mouse is backwards the way you think it should be, that's why.
There. But yeah, just on the top, I have a constant taper of 8 to 1.
Mm-hmm.
And I just did that by changing the top to be a function of the bottom, like the base. And on the other side, I just kept the side constant because I don't really like how it looks when it has a double taper. I think mm-hmm. it looks a little funky, so I just kept that the base width and the top width to be the same. And yeah, in my analysis, I just vary the height as well as the depth of the tower to see like how the outputs change. But yeah, all I changed was just the top base is a function of the bottom base mm-hmm. to keep a constant taper ratio of 8 to 1.
Okay, you said that using just a formula
yeah.
relating the parameters
yeah,
together.
Exactly.
Great. Okay.
Yeah.
You did that in equalize. You did a formula
yeah.
in equalize. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. So here you can see you can only change the can't really see it, but you can only change the base and the depth. And then when you change the depth, it also changes the top depth. And when you change the base, it changes the top base to keep the taper ratio of 8 to 1.
Yeah. When you see some of the parameters that are grayed out, that usually means there's a formula driving them, so you don't get to change it. They're just the result of some other parameters.
Okay.
And we usually do that. Can you actually open up your family? Because
yeah.
I think that might be a good thing to show. Just say edit your family and...
yeah, where do you put the equation to? Can you double click or so to put it on?
Yeah, just right here.
Oh, right there. Yep, we've done that.
Cool. Okay, so do you have a sense of where you're going with all this? Okay, now, don't deep end on it. It really is, yeah, because TENS is sort of exploring broadly, but ultimately, come up with your three, again, the metrics of those. And again, if Dynamo's fighting you and just being very, very finicky, you can spend all your time fighting Dynamo or just export the GBXML. You can always do it manually too. You know, because, you know, although we'd like to get all the tools to work for us perfectly, sometimes they just really fight you. And you're going to lose sleep, especially at this time of the quarter. Like, just kind of fighting software that's buggy sometimes. Okay? So do what you need to, your recommendations more important. Okay, super, excellent. Then let us go ahead and wrap it up for today. Let me thank you all for joining me on this journey through this class. This class is always kind of one of the ones I really enjoy. It's kind of fun in that it's often, every time we go through it, it's new territory and new things break and new things get added. And it's kind of a little bit of a wild ride. And I appreciate your willingness to kind of go on that journey of discovery with me. Hopefully it's kind of been fun to kind of see some of these different things and you're getting a sense of just how new and formative it all is, because you're really at the cutting edge. This is really, in any of the big design firms, this kind of analysis is what people, there's a specialized group who are focusing on doing this type of analysis and doing optimization to really improve the shapes programmatically. So this really is very cutting edge stuff. But I don't know. I have to say, this has probably been my funnest time in terms of iterating through this class and going through the different examples. We've gone off script a lot of times, or several times along the way, just because you came up with really interesting questions. And that made it really interesting for me too. So hopefully you guys enjoyed it too. It was just, you know, we sort of ended up who knows where exactly, but hopefully we covered a lot of good ground along the way, and you are equipped to do some really interesting things as you get out of here. Okay, so super. Thank you for joining me. So I appreciate it. Okay, you guys take care. Woohoo! Finish up! Be free! My pleasure!
Thank you.